As we decode the interim budget of 2019, I'm Shereen Bhan. That was the action in Parliament as Piyush Goyal, the interim finance minister, rose to present the Modi government's last budget in this tenure. The hope on the part of the government is that this will be enough to ensure that they are voted back to office. Now, there's been a little something for everybody, from the farm sector to the salaried class. The question is this enough? Is it too little, too late as far as the farm sector is concerned? Will a consumptive boost be provided to the economy? Will it aid growth? Will it aid a stimulus that the economy has been seeking? And what will this mean now as far as the MPC is concerned? Does it give the MPC room to cut interest rates? Well, all of that and more will be answered over the next 60 minutes on this show. But first up, the man of the hour, Finance Minister Piyush Goyal, who sat down with me to take some of our questions. Take a look. How long did you take to prepare the budget speech? And also, people who've tracked you say that there were specific flourishes in the budget that had the Piyush Goyal signature stamp. For instance, the measures that came in for the housing and the real estate sector, the creative or clever amendment to Section 87A. Is that the Piyush Goyal stamp on the budget?
Well, I promise you, the Honorable Prime Minister and Sri Arun Jaitley had put in all the hard work in crafting the interim budget. It's clearly an interim budget. There are so many things we could have done, we would have liked to do, but...
What more would you have liked to do? You've made several tax proposals, sir, which is unusual, which is
well,
a break from convention.
Well, I kept the tax proposals, tax rates absolutely the same. Hmm. Right now, because these small taxpayers would have otherwise had to suffer the ignominy of having TDS for April, May, June, and then go back to the department and take refunds. Hmm. Our idea was that at least they will have certainty and they can, at least there will be no tax deduction, they won't have the pressure of taxes. And the smaller section, the middle class, which has to plan its budgets, will find it much more convenient given the fact that there is certainty right up front. Hmm. I thought it was necessary to announce that. Some of the measures on housing are practical difficulties which people come and tell us, which I thought would be good. It would give a support to people want to buy a new house, support to affordable housing. Other than that, I think this has remained largely interim.
I don't know how you say it's remained largely interim. Let's talk about the farm package, for instance. Now, you have allocated 20,000 crore rupees in financial year 19 and 75,000 crore rupees, that is for FY20. That doesn't really qualify as a proposal that an interim budget would take forward.
Well, that's a proposal of the current year. Hmm. The scheme is already now introduced and effective from 1st December 2018. So it's a current year proposal and we'll continue into the next year.
Okay, I just want to spend a little time talking about the farm package. To start with, there was a period where the government did not seem to acknowledge that the farm sector was facing a crisis, that there was an agrarian problem that needed to be addressed. A, the opposition says this is too little, too late. Leave that aside. How are you going to implement this scheme? How quickly are we going to see money being allocated into the bank accounts of the beneficiaries? When will the beneficiaries be identified? And how did you arrive at the 6,000 rupee number? Because if you look at all the other estimations that have been done or the current schemes that are available by state governments, it doesn't
correspond
to that.
First of all, madam, this is a mark of respect that this nation is paying to our farmers, particularly the small and marginal farmers, who have served this nation very honorably. Here we have not kept it linked to the area, to the size of landholding. It's a mark of respect for all those with a holding under 2 hectares or up to 5 acres who will get this benefit once every 4 months. So gradually we are moving farming to 3 crop pattern. Hmm. And each crop they will get 2,000 rupees. It may help them in their day-to-day small needs, buy some fertilizer, buy some books for their children, pay the electricity bill. The idea behind it is to actually acknowledge the important role that they are playing and to ensure that the very small farmers also get some benefit. If you look at it, this is the first time a sustainable respect has been given to the farming community. Now, let's take a 10-year period. I would be giving out 750,000 crores to 12 and a half crore farmers over 10 years. look back at what happened from 2004 to 2014. Mm. All that the farmers got was one loan waiver.
Yeah.
That also badly implemented. The CAG has raised all sorts of objections. Mm. Money was siphoned off. Political patronage is evident. Mm. They promised 70,000, provided zero in the 2008 budget, provided zero in the 2009 budget, and left it for the next government to pay. Ultimately, they gave only 52,000 crores, probably to some 3-3.5 crore farmers. Mm. So how much did each farmer get technically at an average? Mm. Some 12,000-14,000 rupees. Mm. And how much did all the farmers, what will they get because of the scheme? 60,000 rupees for every farmer, particularly the small farmers,
6,000.
Up to 6,000 into 10 years.
Yeah.
I'm talking of a 10-year UPA.
Okay.
We'll be giving this every year, consistent.
Sure.
So it's basically an income support, not that it is, it's that income is guaranteed, that income is taken care of. We would love our farmers to have much larger incomes. Hmm. And that is why if you see 4 years, 4.5 years,
yeah.
we have consistently focused on sustainable development. Hmm. We ensured they all got soil health cards. We started investing in all the incomplete, corruption-ridden irrigation schemes of the earlier government. We ensured that electricity is available to the nook and corner of the country at affordable prices. In every respect, MSP, never before in history, all 22 crops got MSP. Mm. I would dare say, what we procure under MSP in 1 year, the UPA did not procure in 5 years. Mm. So I think it's a scheme which is very sustainable. Mm. It's a respect for our annadatas. And as far as implementation is concerned, obviously we'll write to the states. Hmm. States have to give us the lists of landowners because it's all in this, the extract, landholding extract.
Yeah.
From that, they will have to certify and send it to us.
Hmm.
Our idea is that it should be transparent, it should be in the website. The local gram panchayat, everybody should know what everybody, what holding is being declared to the government.
Yeah.
And basis that, there'll be a direct benefit transfer. So we will actually ensure 75,000 crore rupees going to the farmers as against the Congress style, which their own Prime Minister acknowledged that 85% of that is going to get stolen.
I know you,
85% is going to go into corruption.
You mentioned that
85% is going to go into middleman's hand.
You mentioned,
so in the Congress style, 10,000 crore would reach the common man, the farmer.
Sure.
In our working, 75,000 crore.
I know you mentioned this in your speech as well. My limited point to you, sir, is this. And you said that this is a mark of respect to the Indian farmer. Why was this mark of respect not paid earlier then? We've seen farmers protest for the last 2.5-3 years. We've seen the kind of price collapse that has happened. You talked about MSP, but you do a ground check. MSP is not actually being procured. The procurement is not happening at MSP
prices. As I said, it's
so this has not been something that has been brushed under the carpet. It's been there in public discourse and on public display. So why did it take you till the last month of your tenure to deliver on this?
Two aspects to your question. One is about the 5 years. Look at all the actions that have happened over the 5 years. When we did Ayushman Bharat to ensure free healthcare, all these farmers also will get free healthcare. When we bring electricity to every home, all those who are left out would also get electricity connection. When we provided toilets, a mark of respect for the dignity of our mothers and sisters, after all these rural villages, the farmers in these villages, they never had toilets. Mm. One out of three women had the benefit of a toilet in their home.
Right.
Should not somebody answer that for 65 years post-independence?
Mm.
Why did they deprive two out of every three women from a basic amenity like toilet? Why did they have to lose their dignity that they cannot go to a toilet between sunrise and sunset?
Mm.
What this government has done is a consistent and a very progressive way in which development reaches every farmer, every poor person, every middle class person, and it's a whole journey.
Yeah.
After all, what didn't happen for 65 years after independence?
Sure.
We have done twice over in 5 years of one term of the first term of our government.
Yes.
And you still are questioning why is
I'm not here to question what the previous government did or didn't do. I'm only asking you why you chose this time to implement this scheme. But
they all come in a pattern.
But very quickly, if I may get a clarification from you, Arvind Subramaniam, the former chief economic advisor, has put forward the idea of a quasi-universal basic income scheme where it is a center plus state scheme with a matching grant from the state. Do you envisage, if you come to power, that this could in fact take on that shape or form? And the second clarification, one would assume that if you are rolling out a scheme to the tune of 75,000 crore rupees, that there could be expenditure rationalization as far as the agri subsidies are concerned, current agri subsidies. Is that
absolutely not? Not a single current agricultural or any other subsidy has been touched by our government. In fact, which is why you saw 3.3 becoming 3.4, because we provided 20,000 crore more. You saw 3.1, which was our glide path, becoming 3.4 for the next year because we provided 75,000 more. We have been giving honest budgets, and this is also an honest budget. Everything has been provided for, save and except those few unpaid bills that usually come at the end of the year, and cash accounting are paid in the next year. We are not leaving behind 1,60,000 crore of unpaid bills like we inherited in 2014 from the Congress. Having said that, the Arvind Subramaniam formula, you must always juxtapose that with the entire story.
Sure.
What he had recommended is stop giving free or cheap power to the farmers, stop giving free education to the children, stop giving subsidized LPG gas cylinders. We do not believe we should stop all of that. There should be targeted delivery for the poor, for the lower middle class, and we will continue to give them all these benefits.
Let me ask you, sir, moving away from the farm package, because you said that you know, you believe in honest budgets. There are concerns on how the fiscal mass is going to add up. There was an expectation that there would be a slippage. No one is sort of quibbling over the fact that it's 3.4%, but there is apprehension on the glide path having been paused and whether FY21 you will be able to achieve 3% or not. The concern lies on GST, for instance. 1 lakh crore rupee shortfall as far as GST is concerned, you're assuming an 18% growth in GST. Disinvestment, you've done 35,000 crores, you're still hoping to do 80,000 crores in FY19, and you're budgeting for 90,000 crore rupees in FY20. And that's where the concerns stem from. Would you be worried at all as far as the revenue side of the story is concerned?
I don't see that kind of worry, and I'll explain why. First of all, you talked about the fiscal math. The figures finally, if you calculate, are about 3.36 or 3.7%. Now tell me, I'm myself a chartered accountant and the whole government is there. You don't think I could adjust 5,000 rupees and show 3.3?
I said no one's quibbling about
honest,
that.
Yeah. Whatever numbers came from the ground up, bottom up, aggregated whatever number came, the Prime Minister said we give an honest budget, we don't adjust numbers. We stick to what we are going to do. After all, if I'm providing 20,000 additional, it is bound to have some impact.
Yeah.
Because it was not envisaged 1 year ago.
Sure.
Next year, 75,000 is 0.3%. Yeah. So 3.1 became 3.4 for next year. Having said that, the good news is that now with the greater degree of formalization of the economy, I think the CSO is getting it better and better every day. They are able to collect the data of the new economy that's coming into the formal business world. And with the revised numbers of GDP, it seems that we land up the current year with a 3.2% fiscal deficit, and next year maybe only 3.1%.
So on the back of the revised numbers that the CSO put up.
Because a lot of the formal economy, which they were never used to capturing, is now getting captured. As Mr. Jetley rightly says, India for the first time is placing a premium on honesty. And in some sense, the larger collections of direct tax, the larger collections of GST are premised on our success in formalization, greater formalization of the economy. And very clearly, you saw the number of GST this month, about
a lakh and 3,000
crores or thereabouts. It's a, and this is on the back of 80,000 crores of concessions given in the last few months. Now, originally, all the rates were kept at, by and large, lower than the pre-GST level. On top of that, almost 400 items, we reduced the rate. 80,000 crores further given. in income tax, for instance.
Just on GST, can we expect any further rationalization? You've talked about this need to...
Why not? We are always open.
In this financial year.
Well, whenever the GST council needs...
Items like cement, etc., do you believe that now you've crossed 1 lakh crore rupees, you will take that proposal to the council?
Madam, these are decisions with the GST council takes. Government cannot sue more to take that decision. We will obviously be putting up to the GST council, for example, for homeowners. We believe that that's one area where we can, we should have lower rates of GST. We've already submitted it to the council. A group of ministers has been constituted to look at it. And we do hope that they're able to improve some of the anomalies that have come in into the GST tax structure on housing, particularly affordable housing. In the same vein, we may find some other products. I don't know. That's for the GST council to decide. They'll have to balance revenue considerations and the need on the ground for lower rates. But I think a practical approach will always help. Practical approach with lower moderate taxes always expands the base and improves the formalization of the economy. And that's been the success of Prime Minister Modi and Mr. Jetley in successfully moving the nation away from the past into a new world.
Since you're talking about the new world, and I know we don't have enough time, but let me ask you about growth and how confident you feel that the measures you've been able to do today will be able to spur consumption, because that really has been the driver as far as the Indian economy is concerned so far. There are also concerns on the quality of the government's expenditure. For instance, headline capex on account of the central government is forecast to grow at only 6% year on year versus 20% in FY19. And that raises concerns as well on the quality of expenditure. Secondly, the view is, could we see further expenditure compression going forward if the revenue picture doesn't look as rosy as you believe it
does? In the last 5 years, whatever we budgeted, we have met both on revenue and on expenditure. This is one government which has been very prudent in its financial accounting. So therefore, I'm not so sure one needs to already run down the path of if this happens and if that happens. We've been honest in our budgets and we've met our targets. Having said that, the capex cycle obviously needs a greater thrust. But at the same time, the seventh pay commission, we recognize and accept it at one shot. We did not hem and hedge and awe and have huge agitations all over the country before we accepted it. Similarly, if you will see, our focus has been there are certain basic amenities. They may not come in capex. So when I give a toilet, it doesn't come in my capex. When I give electricity or cooking gas or healthcare, it doesn't come in my capex. But I have to ensure that the people of India lead a life of dignity. So we have focused a lot on the basic amenities. With that, we've also been able to do infrastructure and in a big way. Look at railways. We are investing almost 2.5 times what was done 5 years ago in the railway capex. And these days we are very conscious about the economic viability of projects. I'll give you a simple example. The LED program. I've often said it, but $2 billion investment is going to save our consumers, including you, madam, and all your colleagues here, $7 billion every year. Tell me any project anywhere in the world with a better payback.
I know you're very passionate about this. MPC coming up, on the back of the fact that you've missed your fiscal consolidation number and you're gliding for a higher number.
I'm sorry, I have not missed it. I have maintained it. As I told you, it was 3.36. I think anybody will see at the number and appreciate our honesty.
So
you can headline it missed.
I'm not headlining.
I believe we have bettered it.
Okay, so do you believe that the MPC will see this as enough room for it to be able to move as far as interest rates are concerned? And do you also believe that there is a need for a CRR cut, because industry continues to clamor for liquidity?
Let's leave the RBI to do its
job.
We have done ours.
Is liquidity still a problem?
I'm given to understand that no bank is complaining about liquidity right now. I believe even the system liquidity has been significantly improved over the last month and a half. We've seen much more proactive OMO operations. We've seen banks being given more liquidity. The government has issued recap bonds, which has also given liquidity. The good news of three banks' restrictions, PCA restrictions,
being removed
yesterday. So it's a series of long-term sustainable measures that are all playing out and which are all showing signs of huge growth going forward.
So is this it now as far as this financial year is concerned in terms of stimulus, in terms of policy announcements, or can we expect more?
I said it on your channel also and on many public occasions that this Prime Minister never rests.
So we should be ready for more.
Prime Minister Modi is a person who's 24/7 thinking, working, delivering. And he has told me on so many occasions that tum chunav ki kam chinta karo, tum desh mein kya acha hai, deshit aur janit, what is good for the nation, what is good for the people of India. Focus on that.
So what is the next installment? What is the next installment?
Leave the rest to the people.
What is the next installment?
Well, you'll have to interview Prime Minister Modi next time around instead of me. But I do believe he's consistently and very, very passionately working towards a better tomorrow for each and every citizen of this country.
Mr. Goyal, always a pleasure. Thanks very much for joining us on CNBC TV 18. Appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Well, that's the Interim Finance Minister Piyush Goyal defending the budget and the rationale behind the announcements that have come in. But here's more from Arun Jaitley, who's currently in New York as he recovers from medical treatment. Arun Jaitley says that the opposition must not shed crocodile tears and that the government has proven its reformist credentials by not going the loan waiver route but going the minimum income support route. Take a look.
What did the UPA do with it 10 years in power? A one-time loan waiver of 70,000 crores. Only 52,000 crores were waived. And the CAG report was that out of that 52,000 crores, a significant part of the money went to traders and businessmen and not to farmers. So a political group or a party which came out with a national hoax of this kind has the audacity to say that a scheme like this at a pan-India level is too little for people who did virtually nothing. Now look at what we've been doing for the farm sector. Rural roads, 91% completed. Rural housing, 2022, everyone will have a roof. 98.7% people in rural areas now have sanitation. Every willing home is having an electricity. Every poor man has switched over the cooking methods. Interest subvention on loans up to 12 lakh crores being given to farmers. The government is taking the burden of cheaper loans. Higher spending on irrigation, rural infrastructure. Then they get an indirect subsidy and a support. A very large number of them are within Ayushman Bharat, so free health care. Then you have a number of them who get the Manrega benefit, which used to be 28,000 crores during UPA, which is now 60,000 crores. Right to food, cheap ration, 1,90,000 crores. Now, over and above all this, the center says that when you buy your inputs, fertilizer, seeds, etc., I'll give you an initial financial support. Loan waivers are never a solution to the farm sector problem in the long run. And income support still is. We first announced that the farmer will get input cost plus 50%. Many get it, but some, the markets don't give them 50%. So you are giving them this additional support of 6,000. And then you have a federal structure, you have state governments. If Telangana can announce, if Odisha can announce, I'm sure the other state governments can also announce. So please don't shed crocodile tears today for the farmers. If you also, the opposition also has several governments, let them announce similar schemes. I'm sure the other governments within their fiscal space will also consider this. And therefore you can top it up.
Well, the government saying that its 75,000 crore rupee farm package is a first, and this is their way of addressing the problems faced by the agrarian economy. Well, the opposition having nothing of it. Rahul Gandhi taking to Twitter saying that this works out to 17 rupees a day and that was insulting farmers. Similar stories coming in from other opposition leaders as well. Markets largely unperturbed because remember the assumption was that the cost of a scheme like this would be in excess of a lakh and a half, perhaps even 2 lakh crore rupees. At 75,000 crore rupees, the market has made its peace with it. Here's the market's verdict on the farm package.
I'm very happy that this package has been given out. I spend a lot of time on the social field. And when I see that kind of distress, this is clearly most needed and I think has been judiciously done. We must have a termination date for all such things that in the next 5-7 years we will come out of it.
I don't think giving farmers 17 rupees a day is adequately addressing anything. I think it's an insult. I think it's an insult to the Indian farmer to turn around and tell him that you're going to give him 17 rupees every day. I mean, it's there couldn't be a bigger insult than this.
500 rupees may look little, and to us here with whatever per capita incomes we have, mm-hmm. but in a farming household of small and marginal farmer, mm-hmm. it's a significant amount of money. Mm-hmm. I mean, it is something which will improve consumption, mm-hmm. and it will help the farmer. Mm-hmm. to actually pay for in advance, if for example, for some of the inputs that mm-hmm. he or she would want to buy in terms of better quality seeds, mm-hmm. or purchasing even water supplies sometimes that they have to do because they don't have their own irrigation mm-hmm. instruments and so on. So I am not I don't think this is too little.
To start with, the good news is I think the farm relief package was smaller than some had believed or feared. That's about 0.3% of next year's GDP. If you look at the tax rebate, it's about 0.1% of next year's GDP. So the real question is to stick to 3.4 next year. Where will the incremental 0.4% of GDP come from?
I think what is important to keep in mind here is that this targeted 6,000 rupee is above and beyond other schemes that are already there.
Yeah, you're not touching them at all.
Yes. For instance, the minimum support price at 1.5 times cost, which puts a profit margin of 50% of the cost for 23 crops, that's something which is very important. Together with that, you also have other schemes that actually have not been touched. This is, in addition to that.
It's not really income. See, this is basically, if you look at the farmers need this money, at a time of plantation for ensuring that they get enough support for the inputs. Because you cannot have a farm output unless there is an input. So inputs of various kinds, whether fertilizers or whether it is seeds, whether it is insecticides, whether it is pesticides, all of that put together. So this is a sort of a subsidy given to the farmer. Rather than going and approaching a money lender, now he can use this money to be used as his capital for putting into that. So this is his equity. So that equity allows him to get even more loans, so he can leverage it. So this is not the only amount that is available to him. There is also institutional loan that will be available to him. It's his own equity he can put in.
Subsidy is fully covered. The food subsidy is covered. The petroleum subsidy is largely covered because we had factored in a cost of 65 rupees a dollar.
And now
it went up to almost 85,
yeah.
But it has fallen again dramatically. So the calculations are going on. Next year we have given a step up of 13,000 crores. So even if there is a spillover, it will make up for whatever is the shortfall in the current year. Fertilizer is also covered fully.
The scheme which the government of India has proposed excludes no one.
Okay.
So all those who satisfy this criterion will get it, irrespective of whether any state is also paying or not.
But only landowners?
This is correct.
Not tenants?
No.
Okay. And you've been able to identify the beneficiaries?
This exercise now will be carried out by the state governments working with the central government based on the criterian which has been laid out in
so
the scheme.
So when can we expect the first installment to be given out? Because you've said that it's effective retrospectively.
See, the cabinet today approved the scheme. So the scheme is approved. We have provided for this in the current year's budget.
Yes.
So this is ready for delivery. The instructions go to the states today. And this has been made effective from 1st of December.
Mm.
So the 4 months installment, which is 2,000 rupees, will be eligible to be paid during the current year.
Mm.
So the rollout starts now.
I've seen these games being played again and again and again. And I can tell you, in my former birth, I used to do something else, trying to look at election patterns.
Yes. What do you think this means for the elections?
Nothing.
Nothing.
These things happen. They happen routinely. Just remember Mr. Chidambaram's dream budget in 1997.
Mm.
And what happened after 6 months? Government collapsed.
Mm.
Remember what UPA tried to do in 13 and 14? They tried to play all these games. Mm. Nothing. Because the basic thing is this. If the voter is convinced that you haven't done your job, then no matter what you do in the last 6 months, they look, they smile, they of course take the money that's coming their way, and then they vote exactly the way they want to.
Kalia's scheme is completely different from what the union scheme is. Mm. Here, the money, as I understand it, from a little bit of reading that I've done, and I'm not an economist, I'm not like Yogendriji, here the money that will go to the landlord, the landowner. But in Orissa, in the Kalia program, they are taking care of the sharecropper, the tenant farmer, the landless farmer. So that survey is on, and that should also get done by the end of February. And that is a whole different perspective. You cannot equate these two things at all.
17 rupees is 17 rupees. And 1/7 per day is not going to change, irrespective of the sophistry and the verbal jugglery which the BJP or the finance minister may indulge in. And number two, on a far, far more serious note, it is an acknowledgement of the mismanagement of the agrarian economy which this government has overseen in the last 55 or 56 months.
It is a bit rich for the Congress today to be all flustered about farmers, given the fact that this agrarian distress is not something that was made in the last 4 years. This is a distress that has been created by 6 decades of absolute callous, negligent conduct of the agricultural economy. And this government is trying to create a sustainable, permanent solution to the plight of farmers and the agrarian sector. So I think the phrase, "this is a bit rich," applies more to the Congress when it comes to farmers and the public sector assets than anybody else in this country.
Well, not just the farmers, the salaried class also got some sweetness. So if you have an income of up to 5 lakh rupees, there will be a full rebate that you will be allowed. There was some confusion on that, but the clarification broke right here on CNBC TV 18. So what should the salaried class make of the changes that have been announced on the rebate as well as standard deduction? What does it mean for you and me? Take a look.
The middle class of this country has certainly contributed. There's been a dramatic improvement in tax compliance. They've also, of course, borne the brunt of many changes we made, which are long-term changes, which are good, like GST and so on. But nevertheless, it did cause some amount of stress to them. So it was thought that at least the lower and middle class should be again also given certain amount of relief.
This was the first ever budget presented by a chartered accountant. So as a chartered accountant fraternity, it makes me feel very, very proud. With regard to the rebate, I think it's a very innovative way of looking at taxes. So what you're doing is you're not really reducing the rate of tax. You're not increasing the slab. All that you are saying is people who have earned income up to 5 lakhs will not be required to pay tax, but because they get a rebate, they'll be required to file their tax returns. Now, what that does is it continues to provide all the information to the tax office, ensures that they have all the data relating to this. This should impact about 3 lakh crore taxpayers.
His focus was clear. Salaried taxpayer.
Correct.
We spoke about that pre-budget and we said that's the constituency for which something is going to happen. 250 to 500,000, add all the deductions, take it to 650, 700,000. That's a very, very meaningful jump. Take it a different way. It's taken India more than 5 years to get from the 50,000 to 250,000. And we are moving in one step from 250,000 to 500,000. So I think it's a very meaningful jump. I think it makes the salary taxpayer, the honest taxpayer, particularly at the middle class level, very happy. And obviously it's got to have both positive impact, hopefully, on the government, but also on the consumer product.
These are all effective first of April. Yes,
okay.
These are beginning new year. For the salaried class, that deduction for 5 lakh taxable income earners actually belongs to for the income earned and tax paid for the current year, which is the previous year. They'll get the rebate in the next year.
In a way, it increases the efficiency of tax collection because, you know, this segment may not have material impact in terms of resources of the government to create finances by giving this benefit or advantage. So you're in a way eliminating a lot of tax hassles for a large part of the population which is paying tax today. But that apart, I think over time we'll realize the impact of these actions because things don't change.
If you're earning a salary income of 5 lakh 50 without any investments, they've increased the standard deduction from 40 to 50. So 5 lakh 50 total income, 50,000 standard deduction, you come to 5 lakhs. You add something more, 7 lakhs income, 1.5 lakhs investment deduction, 50,000 standard deduction, you come to 5 lakhs. So the magic here is get your taxable income to below 5 lakhs and you earn this.
Such a practical way, the finance minister has said that he has really benefited the farmers and the middle class. And they are both the consumer classes and they are both being targeted today. They are both under stress today, whether it is tax reduction at source and trying to get a refund, or whether it is a second house, or, you know, extension of the tax credit. Flats are not being sold. Real estate is in a bit of a stress. One of the reasons being GST on under construction flats. I think Prime Finance Minister has taken a practical view that unsold stock increase can be from 1 year to 2 years. So there's no notional rent because it's taking longer time for developers to sell apartments. So I think it's a very, very positive move. Even for individuals who sell house and there is a capital gains, and developers who have unsold stock who are trying to sell. I think these are very good measures and more practical measures.
Absolutely change in the taxpayer's mindset now. And we are getting a higher returns. Number of returns are increasing. The tax base has gone up. And the per return income has also gone up. That is why we could get a tax growth rate of 18% last year. Before that, it was 15%. So we are continuously getting a good tax growth, and the persons are moving from a non-tax compliant society to a tax compliant society. And we want that the more taxpayers should be honest. The honesty should be given a benefit. Honesty should be, you know, encouraged. So the persons are coming more into the tax net.